Hi, and welcome to this installment of Frank and Mary here in Marlborough. If you haven't seen this show before, my name is Art Bergeron. My day job, as many of you know, because I'm from Marlborough, is I work as an elder law attorney at Myrick O'Connell. But this is not about my day job. It's about my friends, Frank and Mary. If you've seen my presentations before, I'm always talking about Frank and Mary and their goal in life, which is to live in their house until they die and be buried in the backyard. And if that's Marlborough, that means they want to be right here, like forever, right? And so the question is, if you are here and you identify with Frank and Mary, who are the people you need to know? What are the programs you need to know about in order to live in Marlborough forever, right? And so one of the programs you may want to know about is a program, I bet you've passed this sign 1,000 times. There's a wonderful group called AgingWell that has a day program here in Marlborough for folks. And we invited Laurie Imparato from AgingWell to kind of talk about it and give you a sense, you know, of whether this is a program that you may want at some point, that you know you have a loved one who may want. And so we're just going to kind of talk about that. So Laurie, thank you very much for coming on.
Sure, thank you for having me.
I really appreciate it. So if could you start off by just telling us just a little, well, first of all, like, who are you? Are you a Marlborough person? Are you from far away?
I live in Bellingham, Mass. I'm the program director with Aging Well Adult Day Health Center. I'm also a nurse. I started here, almost 11 years ago, 2 days a week, and just, you know, stayed. And here I am now as the program director, loving the center as much as I did when I started.
That's great. So yeah. Can you talk a little bit about Aging Well and kind of a little bit about the history of, you know, how it ended up, what it is, how it ended up here, and then, you know, who you're helping? Because I know I've had clients who have been down there that you've helped a lot of people. Who are you helping?
Yeah, we started out, I want to say the program's about 12 years old. We were owned by two women. We were acquired by the Mentor Network 3 years ago, which is a big corporation. It's much bigger. They have a lot of different types of centers, but one of their big things is adult day health. My center, Aging Well, we cater to people, adults with disabilities, the elderly, Alzheimer's, dementia patients, folks that just need to get out, or family members that need respite, just a little bit of a break. We're open every day. People start arriving here at the center at 7:45 in the morning. We're open till 4 in the afternoon. And they come in, they have their breakfast, they have lunch, they have a snack. They do many wonderful activities, arts and crafts. We have a large Mandarin population. They do dancing.
You have a large Mandarin, you have a large Chinese, like a Mandarin Chinese population.
We do. So we
now
have.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
How did that happen?
Well,
I've been in Marlborough for a long time. And I know that, for example, there's a large Chinese population in Northborough, right? But I don't think about that being a lot of folks that are here. But of course, you're dealing with several communities, right?
We are dealing with several communities. When I first started, we had 48 people at the center. Our center has grown. It's a very big center. And we realized that there wasn't any programs around for Mandarin elderly. So we, you know, focused, we have our English speaking program. We have our Memory Lane program, which is for Alzheimer's and dementia. And then we focused on our Mandarin program. So they come from Framingham, Worcester, Acton, Maynard. So there's a large population.
I think kind of more generally, it's a challenge for folks and for folks who've got parents here who came from another country and who are now older.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's tough to be old in a foreign language, you know, and so you kind of want to be back in your own language and you want to be kind of with some folks that you know. So that's a wonderful that's a wonderful additional service. So you said that people, you kind of described a range of people who come, right?
Yes.
And that's really a range. So you said you've got some folks, so many of the people that I deal with are older people who've got some memory issues, right?
Yeah.
They may have some physical problems, right? But they may also have some memory issues.
Yes.
Can you talk about, you know, the folks who were there who may have some memory problems together with, you know, some related problems? And to start off with, you said that they show up. So do you have any transportation? Do you provide any transportation yourself, or do people need to come to you? And can you just mention to folks who haven't actually walked in the door, where are you exactly?
We are located, we're at 420 Maple Street in Marlborough. We're near the Encompass Gym in the back of the building. We have two ramps on each side, so we're easy to see, and you see all our big vans in the back. We do have transportation. We offer that. We used to contract with a company, but now we provide our own transportation. It's in-house, so it's actually much easier. It makes it easier for us to go out on trips and outings and do different things during the day. But our participants, like I said, we have memory impaired people. Many of our participants are memory impaired. But, you know, they can be in the main surrounding, out in the main area with the groups and allowed. The noise doesn't bother them. Our memory lane participants are people with more advanced dementia that overstimulation would be just too much for them. So we have a small group in a memory lane area that does individual activities with two staff members in that room. So it's a much better fit for that group. So we try to, organize our day with the people that we do have attending. Sometimes we do have some behaviors. We have 8 nurses on staff here at the center.
8,
yes.
Wow.
Yep. And I'm a nurse myself, so that makes 9. So we have 9 nurses. We are a medical model, adult day health center. So
I was going to say, speak to that a little bit. What does that mean?
So we have participants that need, wound care. They need medicine during the day. They might need nebulizer treatments. They might need some oxygen. They just might need, a nursing check throughout the day. So we have that. Each person that comes to our center has their own care plan nurse. So that nurse is assigned to a particular amount of caseloads, and they follow those caseloads. We've found a lot of things and helped a lot of people before things became too serious. We do send people out. We had somebody about a week ago who just didn't look right. And our nurses caught that when they were doing her blood pressure. And, we called 911 and we knew she was having a stroke. And the woman came back that Monday, but it was, if she was at home, that woman wouldn't maybe be back here today. So it's a wonderful, ADH is, adult day health is a wonderful service for people. It really is.
And I so often talk to, to clients, and I say, everybody, like Frank and Mary, everybody wants to be at home. And of course, especially if you have memory issues, right? Well, I think if you have anything, but especially if you have memory issues, because, you're always going to know where you are kind of at home. Yeah. You're going to know where the bathroom is, and you're going to know where the salt and pepper is. And right. So I said, it's wonderful to be at home as long as it's safe.
Right.
As long as it's safe. But as I say to people, there's a point at which it's just too risky to be at home. And home a lot of times isn't laid out kind of correctly. Right. And the issue with home is who's home, who else is home, right. And once again, I still remember going to, so I'm French Canadian. So I still remember going to Meme's house. We go to Meme's house, which is actually right. It was right here in Marlborough, right? Actually, I go by the house occasionally. There's a maple tree that my uncle had planted in the front yard, which is now this gigantic maple tree in one of the clover leaves at the 495 interchange. It was one of the houses that got torn down in order to build 495, But when I go to Meme's house, and I remember I talked to my older sisters, because Meme was pretty old, and I never remember her saying anything. She was just sitting in this rocking chair, rocking. And my older sisters later told me, they said, yeah, Meme would really speak ragtime sometimes. She would just be... But the point was, she was there, and there was my aunt who had moved in to take care of her, and there was my uncle who was single, you know, and there were and every there's always family moving around because there were jillion kids, you know. That family doesn't exist. That kind of that stereotypical 50s family doesn't exist, you know. So to have to be Meme all by herself, or with just Pepe there, you know, with just their husband, and your husband's the same age as you are, and maybe mentally a little bit more aware, but, you know, not, you know, not can't lift you up, you know, and can't do these things, you know. So to have that is a wonderful thing. It's just
It is really. And it also, you know, helps the individual, the participant that comes to our center, because we offer so many things for the family. Like, we offer showers here at the center. We have the podiatrist that comes. He just came here Monday. He comes every 9 weeks. We have normally not COVID. We can't have any contractors in the facility right now, but normally we have a hairdresser that works 2 days a week. So she comes in and cuts everybody's hair for free. We have an acupuncturist that normally comes. We go into Chinatown. We go to Quincy to do grocery shopping. We take our other participants to ice cream. We go for walks at the high school track. On Saturdays, we would go to the kids' t-ball games or soccer games to just kind of be with the community, you know, and be out and about and be with the kids. So it's a really, it also gives everybody a little break from each other, you know, where the participant comes here and they see their friends and they're social and they're stimulated in a different way than they are at home. So I actually did put together a few little crafts just to show, like, this is something that one of our participants did, and it's lovely. This here, our Chinese participants really love origami. So this is origami things. So they make a lot of nice things. They bring home things and they're proud of them. And it gives more quality to their life, you know, gives them a little more quality. And we notice things here, and we are connected with Minuteman Elder Services, Bay Path Elder Services, and Tri-Valley Elder Services. So we reach out to all their case managers. We reach out to all their doctors. So it's a team of people now that are seeing and having eyes on our elderly in the community that helps keep them safer and helps them be able to stay at home longer.
And I'd always tell folks, you know, I said, you know, the thing about having a memory issue is if you're the caregiver, it's hard being with someone who has a memory issue all the time because and you get nervous about them with folks who don't have memory issues.
Yes.
But the interesting thing about it is if you're with other people who have memory issues, then it's not an embarrassment anymore. It's a joke. You know, it's just like, it's just, that's the way it is. You know, people don't remember stuff. Right. And so it, you know, it not only is it providing like a respite for the caregiver, right? But in many ways, it's providing a respite for the person who's got memory problems.
Exactly.
Especially, as you say, if they are dealing not only with other folks who've got some memory problems, but also with folks who are used to dealing with folks with memory problems.
Yeah.
And who therefore have this ability to kind of let it go, you know, and it's not this, oh, don't you remember that, you know, don't you, of course you remember. No, I don't, you know. Yep. And so that's kind of like the way it is, right? So can you go back a little bit to so a person shows up and you said that you have breakfast there?
We do. Yep. So the buses start arriving around 7:45. As people come in, it's a little different with COVID. Like I said, we serve people as they get here because with COVID, we have different protocols that we're following, and we can only have 6 people on a 14 passenger bus now. So it's taking us much longer to get people to arrive to the center. And right now we're only at 40% capacity. We have a much lower number just for safety and infection control. So people will arrive. They'll come in and we serve everybody breakfast. They can get coffee, tea, eggs, muffins. We just, you know, we have a menu. So we cook that breakfast every day. Around 11 o'clock, they have their snack. In between that, they're doing activities, crafts. They do morning exercise. They like to listen to music. on our English-speaking side, they like to listen to music. They love to do karaoke, word search. They do a lot of word games. Again, with COVID, it's individual activities, so we can't have any group activities.
And by the way, you said on the English-speaking side. So in other words, for the folks who are the Mandarin Chinese folks, yep. they're doing basically similar activities, but on the Chinese side and in China.
Yeah, we call ourselves one program, but honestly, because of the language barrier, it's a preference. The English people tend to stay together and the Mandarin-speaking tend to stay together. And we do have translators. You know, we have translators for all of the Chinese population. We do have some Portuguese folks here too, and a lot of our nurses speak Portuguese. So
I was just—I guess that was what I was leading me up to, because I would. My sense is that the folks that I see, because I see a lot of older folks, you know, yeah. who are older and whose native language isn't English,
right,
are mainly Azorean folks,
right.
who were mainly in Hudson, right?
Yeah, yes.
But that's a big chunk of people, right?
Yeah,
they've been coming over for a long time, you know.
Yeah.
And that even as opposed to the kind of current Brazilian wave of people coming in who tend to be younger.
Yes.
Right? You know, yeah. Maybe their parents are coming, but you know, because of this, you know, because of the chain migration and stuff, but mostly they're younger, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I was wondering if that is evolving there, this cluster of, you know, Azorean, you know, older folks from the Azores.
Yep. So that's why we do have some Portuguese speaking staff. We have a CNA that speaks Portuguese. We have another one that speaks Spanish and Portuguese. And then we have Portuguese and Spanish speaking nurses. So it works nicely to have the variety of languages, you know, the staff that can speak the languages. It really helps.
And it sounds like you've got several rooms. You must have.
We're a big center.
You've got to have a lot of space there. Yeah. Cause
we do.
So I'm, you know, once again, I'm so old that I still remember that as being the inland trucking site, right? That was,
yeah.
That was a trucking company when my brother-in-law, whose nephew is now the mayor, he and his brothers had the trucking company across the street.
Yes.
So you must occupy quite a bit of the space in that building then.
We do. We've done two additions since I've been here. So we had the main space and then we added on to the right and then we added to the back. So we have a really nice, we have a dance room with mirrors. We have, you know, the hair salon. We have a back room with four big rooms and then a big ping pong table room, yeah. A pool table room. So we have a lot of space.
I'm interviewing you, but my memory of aging well is a 6-year-old or an 8-year-old memory, right?
Right.
You've obviously got way more than I thought was in that building, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So how many people are you seeing every day? That's a different question. How many people are you seeing now, and how many people were you seeing before COVID?
Okay, before COVID, our capacity is 192. That's how many we can have in our building.
Yeah.
Our census was between 180 and 190 every day. With COVID, we are holding it ourselves. It's our own number. We feel comfortable with, our participants feel comfortable, is between 65 and 70.
I get it.
So
I get it.
That's what we're doing now. We did, you know, we accept a lot. I think you had asked me before, the insurance that we accept.
Yes. Can you talk a little bit, talk about what this costs, how that works,
yep.
And then talk about insurance a little bit.
Sure. So the cost of a basic participant is somebody who really doesn't have a lot of needs. They might just need a shower if they come to the center, or they might just need an oversight with a nurse, you know, maybe once or twice a week. That's a basic need for us,
yep.
At the center. So that person would cost $58.83 a day. And that's, you know, about $60 a day. And it's $27 round trip for transportation. So if you were only going to take one way, it would be $15. So, I mean, really, for the day that you're going to have two meals, the transportation, it's a pretty, you know, it's very inexpensive.
Is everybody there as a full day? Does the program always run as a day? There are no half day.
Well, that a lot of our private pay participants, they can do whatever they like. They can come as, you know, we used to have a person who only just wanted a little respite. So she would drop her husband off for 2 to 3 hours a day, and then she would pick him up, you know, at lunchtime, and they would go home and she would be happy, and that worked for them. For us, with the insurance, we have to have participants here for 6 hours a day. Mm-hmm. With COVID, it's been 3 hours a day, just because they understand how long it's taking us to get people home with less people on the buses and to be, you know, safe.
I didn't mean to interrupt, but talk about that. What kind of insurance, if any, covers any of that care?
Sure. So we, a lot of our participants, most of our participants have MassHealth. They have SCOs off of MassHealth. We accept Commonwealth Care Alliance, Senior Whole Health, United Healthcare, Tufts, Fallon, and then we have private pay participants where their families just, you know, pay themselves, or long-term care insurance will cover it. So there's a lot of different options. Sometimes people don't have the insurance that will cover it, but they do need services. So often Minuteman or BayPath will cover a day or two.
I see.
And they have like a BayPath fund or a Minuteman fund, and they can reach out to their BayPath or their elder services in their community that represents them. And they, you know, they will determine, and they will help them pay for what they need also.
And the other thing that I try to emphasize to clients is that they don't appreciate that even though you're not going to the hospital here, right? That for people who have these kinds of fairly serious memory impairments, these expenses are all going to be tax deductible. They're all going to be legitimate medical expenses. You need to document it correctly. But I think that's really important for a lot of people to realize, you know, that for many of these folks who have got where your primary asset often is tax deferred money, IRA or 401k money, right? Yep. That this is actually an ideal use of that money.
Oh, yes.
Because you can be pulling it out. And normally, you know, the last thing a senior ever wants to do is touch that money because they're afraid, because they're paying tax, then they're going to pay tax on it.
Right.
But a lot of times they can pull that out and use it for this program.
Yeah.
And as a result, they're basically using all of the dollars because your program costs as a medical deduction. So it's
we're a medical model. So we're all licensed nurses, social worker. We keep all the same documentation that they do at the doctor's office.
Yeah.
So
tell me, so, you know, I'm actually on the board of a Better Day, which is a much smaller, the social day, right? So can you just talk about who would be a person who would want to be going to Aging Well, who would not be appropriate, you know, what would be the person who really needs to be going to Aging Well, right? As opposed to somebody who would be going to Better Day. So people can just get a sense of, because I know that a lot of this is a progression, as I always tell people. I mean, the hard part about memory problems is it's all goes in one direction, you know, and the goal is to have as good a life for as long as you can, but to be constantly adjusting, you know.
Now, is Better Day the old Pleasantries?
That's correct. Better Day is the old Pleasantries. Yeah.
Okay. So the owner of Better Day, Tammy and I used to kind of work together where we would, when she would have people more social, they were able to do more for themselves. They just had, you know, dementia, mild dementia.
Right.
They didn't really have behaviors. And Tammy would, when they advanced, and she really couldn't handle that anymore. And she couldn't meet their needs, she would reach out to me. And then we would always work with the families and have the family come here because we have the ability to care for people with higher needs. The people that we wouldn't be so good with are the people that have the higher needs. They might be bored. They might want to be there more just for social versus redirection. We have staff all the time in every room. We have staff. So this person might not be as happy here, but we do have some very independent people here, but they may have some cognitive issues. So we have some younger people that have cognitive issues or physical disabilities, and they have all their friends here and whatnot, but a person who might just be a little forgetful might want to be with a group of their peers that maybe just are a little forgetful also. They may not like this environment.
Well, I guess my suggestion to people who are watching this is, you know, first of all, you don't realize how lucky you are to be in like Marlborough, Hudson, in this immediate area, right? Yeah. And to have options like this.
Oh, yeah.
Many people are in places, right, where these options don't exist, right?
Yeah.
So that's the first thing. The second thing is, so shop around, you know, go look, you know, go look. So check these places out, but also, you know, plan, check it out ahead of time. If you have memory problems, if you have a loved one who has memory problems, and you know you don't need these services right now or feel that you don't, right? Well, go visit. Just go visit, because that will also give you kind of a sense of what, of as your loved one changes, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That there are these options and that you're not just afraid. You're not just hiding in your house. Oh my God, what's happening? And feeling like you're just going kind of down a rat hole. You know, this is just really, really important. If you're Frank and Mary, and if you're Frank and you're taking care of Mary, or Mary taking care of Frank, or you're one of the kids, their names are Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr., by the way. I always tell people, if you're old enough to get the joke, you're old enough to be my client, you know? So, if you're a family member, check these places out, right? It's a wonderful thing that we have these services here, and they have transportation, which is a big deal. You know, if you're trying to figure out how to manage all of this stuff.
Yeah.
So, Lori, this has been really helpful, I think. I think this can be helpful for a lot of people, you know, and Lori, just for folks who are just watching here at the end, if they needed to contact you, what would they do? Where would they call? And what would the email address be? We'll put this up also. Okay.
Sure. They would call Lori at AgingWell, and the number is 508-485-7700. And it's Lori.imparato, Imparato, at thementornetwork.com.
It's a long one, but we're going to have a banner so you can see this. And just call her. Just call her.
Information, because we often get calls, just people desperate in need, and we can refer them to the right people if they just need some help.
Right. Because these folks, you know, people aren't, you know, in this, people aren't like really competing in a lot of this stuff.
A lot of us work together. Better days. We still work together. You know, we've been working on the COVID chats for all of our people together. So,
I mean, you can tell looking at Laura, you know, these aren't these like really tough, you don't go into these jobs because you're grouchy, you know, you go in because you like working with people, right? Right. So Lori, thank you so much. I really, really appreciate you taking
thank
the time.
Thank you, folks.
I hope you enjoy this program. You know, look around. If you think that this might be helpful to you, it's handy. It's very handy. It's right here in Marlborough, right? So thank you very much for watching, and we'll look forward to seeing you on the next installment of Frank and Mary here in Marlborough. Thank you very much.